Hi, welcome. My name's Paul Fisher. I'm a member of the Laycock Art Group in Wiltshire, UK. This is my second video demonstration, again based on a demonstration that I did at Laycock last year. And this demonstration follows on directly from the my first video, which was about the quick and simple way of stretching watercolour paper. I did a demonstration last year based on what I call the wet spray method of painting animals. I found about a year ago that the animals that I was painting, they tended to be a bit stifled, a bit stiff. They looked as though they'd been shot and then nailed to the perch. There was no movement to them. And even if an animal is stock still, perhaps because it's hunting or whatever, it will move. There'll be wind in its feathers or its fur, it'll be breathing. And I think with anything that's alive, you want to show some form of movement. And I found that by experimenting with the water element of watercolour, using it not just as a vehicle to get the pigment down onto the paper, but to use it to move the pigment around, that I started to get a fair degree of success in painting animals which felt as though they were, or looked as though they were, alive. Now, as I say, this follows directly on from the first DVD, or the video, where we were stretching paper, because one of the essential elements to this method is that the paper that you use should be well stretched. It wants to be relatively heavy, sort of 300 gram. I'm using 300 gram Waterford here. On top of the board at the moment, you'll see an example of the demonstration I did at Laycock last year, a puffin. And you can see around the edge how it's all fuzzy, all furry. It looks as though the animal is actually moving. So you need your paper stretched. You need, obviously, water. Good to have two clear jars of water. I tend to try and do as little mixing of my colours in the palette as I can. And this whole technique is really about allowing the pigments to float on top of the sprayed water and to mix themselves on the paper. So we need a spray bottle and a tissue. I've got a palette here of some colours because for the smaller areas, like the colourful beaks and so forth, and the feet and so on, I don't need to use vast quantities of pigment. But when it comes to dropping pigment onto the water that I spray onto the paper, I use it directly from the tube. And the colours I'm going to use are ultramarine blue, that's a Winsor & Newton ultramarine blue. Burnt umber, that's a Marie blue colour. That I'll use to make up the sort of dark black element of the puffins. And then I shall back that up with a bit of Shinhan indigo. I've also got some Daniel Smith colours here. I've got Hansa yellow and Pyrrole red, which I can use on the legs and beak and so forth as well. I'll also use a small amount of cadmium orange. Right, so the first thing that we do, I'm going to, as you see, I've already sketched the, I've sketched two puffins here. I'll concentrate on one really, most of the time. The first thing to do is to use the spray to basically get a good layer of water. Spray both of them onto the paper. Now, for darks, for blacks, the feathers on the puffin are more or less black. You want to, I use a colour mix, which is a mixture of the ultramarine blue, which I drop in first, and then when I drop in the burnt umber, find that the two mix together on the paper and make a really nice, warm, dark which is quite essential. So, before that dries, wet the brush. And drop that directly into the water. So that's straight from the tube. It wants to be fairly thick. The room is quite warm, and so consequently the colour is drying quite rapidly, but that's okay because I can respray it. And then we've got the top. I find that this method of getting a dark ultramarine blue followed by burnt umber means you get a lot of lovely warm greys. And on the top of the animal's head, on top of the bird's head, where you've got most light falling, you can get some nice soft light greys, where the light is reflecting off of the top of the head. So, having got that in, can you see how fuzzy it's beginning to go around the edge there now? Quite good. So in with the burnt umber. You need to be relatively quick, but you can just slow things up a little bit by spraying more water onto the painting. That's going nice and dark. But I'm getting a range there of darks, a range of grey, of blacks and greys, which is rather nice. And it's warm because I'm using a nice warm colour net. Well, ultramarine blue is a warm blue. And the burnt umber is obviously a nice warm colour too. And the nice thing about this method is that if you keep the pigments wet on the paper, you can then sculpt them and move them around using your brush, which is great. Okay, so that's beginning to look okay. Now I'm just going to back that up again with a bit of this Shinhan indigo. This is a lovely rich colour. You could argue that I could go straight in with this, but I wouldn't then have those patches of nice warm grey if I did that. You'd have one sort of relatively uniform colour with slightly different tones, which is not quite the same thing. Okay. Look how fuzzy that's going. It's really, I find that quite quite exciting. In fact, what I often have to do at this stage is to actually sculpt the paint using a nice, what I call a hungry brush. But in this case, because we've got a very warm room, I don't think we're going to need to do that. Okay. So, I'm going to let that dry. Now this has actually gone back to being almost dry again, so I'm going to respray that for the little young one. Got to be careful here, I'm terrible at putting my darks in to the wrong place. So I usually sketch over where the dark areas are just to remind me where they need to be. So I'm going to just concentrate here a little bit. There we go, in goes the blue. And he's actually moving a bit quicker than his parent bird. He's actually skipping around of some sort, so he perhaps needs a bit more movement, which is fine. Look what's happened to the top of his head. It's really gone quite fuzzy. And of course, in watercolour painting, if we're very careful, we tend to find that quite abhorrent, but it's absolutely gorgeous the way that the water is transporting the paint away. That's fine. The rest of his body there is more or less white. There's maybe a little bit of blue around here. He might actually need a little bit of a haircut in a second. I'll go in now with my burnt umber. So I just briefly wet the brush, dip it into the tube. It's so enjoyable. I mean, I find this one of the most enjoyable ways of painting watercolours. And I have indeed used it, not just for animals, although I think it's particularly relevant for animals, but also for buildings. Now, buildings you wouldn't have thought needed much movement, but it's just a way of getting texture and a bit of excitement into what could otherwise be quite a dull painting. Now, on this little one, I'm going to do a bit of sculpting. So what I do, use a hungry brush, which is same brush again. Just to let you know, I'm using a Da Vinci Maestro Sable brush, size 6. Which is a nice brush to use. You can see he's gone quite wild. That's okay. I'm going to sculpt by using a hungry brush and move some of that colour around, remove some of the colour, and also just move it around a little bit too. Maybe give him a little bit less of a fuzzy top. He's looking quite fuzzy, poor guy. He really is having a bad hair day. But that's fine. That's okay. I'm going to leave his wing area. I think that's perfectly okay. That's all right. Good. I'll shove a little bit of indigo into that now at the same time. Just to give him a bit of... Remember that animals are three-dimensional, so we're wanting to give that feeling of 3D. And you can do that by different tones and so forth. And this is a lovely way of the way this is working. Lovely way of doing that. Right. It still looks a bit fuzzy, but that's okay. That's fine. This is all a bit of fun. This is not... It is serious painting, but it's... We want to produce a smile on the people who look at the painting. Now, I'm going to go back to the parent bird, Big Bird, and I'm just going to define a little bit. This is his breast is essentially white, but of course they're a little bit dirty very often. So I'm going to use a little bit of yellow ochre, a little bit of my hands are yellow in there as well. Just to work on that, and a little bit of burnt umber. Show a bit of dirt, that's fine. On the side of the head, around the eyes, there's this lovely sort of mauvey colour, and for that I'm going to use a bit of diazone violet. Again, a Winsor & Newton colour. Just tone it down a little bit with burnt umber. And I use it here because I also use it for the shadow underneath. And so it's nice to get these colours talking to each other. Now that's a bit much, actually. So I'm going to just knock that back with a hungry brush again. Just sculpt it a little bit. Paper there is still a bit damp, which is fine. It's okay. Just remove that, just got a little bit too much in there. And then sometimes we have the... I've painted so many puffins now, you get to know them quite well. So, there we go, that gives a bit of shape to the puffin's cheeks. I can do this, go back to the little fella and do a little bit there too. On his tummy. Give it a bit of shape. Things to do is to keep things simple. We don't want to make things too complicated. He really has got a woolly barnet, this guy. Let's just knock some of that back. That's okay. Just takes some of that tone off of there. We need tone there anyway, because I'm now going to do the same as I did with the parent bird and put a little bit of that in. That's fine. Good. Okay. Like the way that's gone there, that's perfectly okay. I'm going to use the hands of yellow now. Cad yellow is perfectly okay for this, but they have this sort of yellow button type thing just about there. Put some yellow into that. Put a little bit of yellow, into his legs and feet. Same with our cheeky chappy here. Going okay, right. And then I'll take a bit of cad orange just to put a bit more onto that. Not being particularly accurate, really don't need to be that accurate, to be honest with you. Again, it's all to do with movement. And I'll put a little bit of, I'm using a highly technical ornithological term here, the button on the side of the head, and just maybe just a little touch of my red, parallel red, just to give it a bit of additional colour there. That's okay. Okay. Good. As I say, I could respray these if I wanted to get a bit more. In fact, I'll do a little bit of respraying there just to get that to flow a bit more. Don't need too much, that'll go okay. Right, we can look at the beak area now too. Start that off with a bit of the old Hansa yellow. The other thing about puffins is that they just look so cute. Of course, that when they're mating and so on, they've got these very, very colourful beaks. Starting off there with the Hansa yellow, add a little bit of orange to it whilst it's still wet. Cut orange. Maybe put a little bit more down there too. They've got this sort of orange ring around their eyes, so I'm just going to introduce that. There, okay. You've got to gauge just how wet and how damp the paper is to see how much detail work you can do. The beak there is flowing a little bit. Now I'm going to take my parallel red and stroke some of that into the beak area, picking up enough there. There we go, that's all right. Same there. Okay. Good. And now what I can do is a bit of work on the eyes. I think the paper is dry enough. There's this sort of crease mark there, going up to there, and you've got this sort of little bit down there. Same on our little buddy. Oops, maybe a bit too damp there, doesn't matter. Back to that, that's fine. Good. He's had a really bad hair day, this guy. Anyway, that's all right. And in fact, what I'm going to do right now is just dry that off with a hair dryer. Okay, so I've given them a quick going over with the hair dryer. I'm going to just define with more colour some of these areas here. The fact that the fuzziness has come out well away from the shape is perfectly okay. It just, at a distance, it just gives that indication of movement, which is great. So I'm just going to go back of some of these areas. They're not quite as bright as they might be. Use a bit of burnt umber in the legs and so on. It will look nice and three-dimensional. Do the same for our little fellow. Bit of burnt umber for him as well. So this is very much working wet into wet, which is great. Shape his beak a bit more there. Good. That's okay. Right. Not too far from being finished, actually. little details to put in. We need the eyes. So in the middle of that orange disc, just a little circle there with a bit of a white highlight. Actually, as a parent, he looks a bit worried. A worried expression on his face. Detail around there. Maybe a little bit more shadowy work down here. And now we can think about the background. Now, I tend to leave the skies white. If you start painting the skies, if they're standing on a rock, for instance, if you start painting the skies too blue, you tend to shut the painting down, which I don't want to do. So I'm just going to put in basically a basic floor, if you like, just painting in a bit of yellow ochre. No need. This is going to become more or less a vignette, really, so I'm leaving a fair amount of white paper. We just want enough ground to plant them in, nothing more than that. Whilst that's wet, drop in a bit of burnt umber, just to give it a bit of wild texture. Good. Maybe give that a bit more there as well. It's nice to use colours in the same colour in two or three different places. You get colours talking to each other, then there's it produces a unity which is important. Using a lot of wet into wet, wet against wet. Darkening one or two little areas up. That's fine. It's looking okay. Maybe just extend that over there a little bit. The feet at the ends of the toes, if you like, that's what they're called, have these sort of quite dark. Sort of toenails. So I would normally now leave that to just dry until it got quite sort of damp, and then I put in the shadow work. To save time, I'm going to again just dry that with a hairdryer. Right, we're nearly there. I'm just going to put in one or two little lines here and there, just tidy up in one or two places. The beaks themselves are not all nice and clean yellows, oranges and reds. There's a few dirty marks in there. Don't want to make too many hard marks, because it takes away from the fact that these things are these birds are actually moving. That's okay. Notice here, I've removed some of the pencil work there, and therefore, because there's no background, that breast there is not defined. But I don't think you should be afraid of that. I think it's very good to see bits of an object disappearing into the sky or the sea or whatever else, or into just white paper. You must remember that the eye of the viewer very often fills in what you don't put in yourself, and it actually makes the viewer do a little bit of work, and that's always good because it helps to keep their attention on your picture. Okay, so now I'm just going to put in a bit of shadow work, not too much. It's very easy to make the shadows take over the picture if you're not careful. And for this, I'm using diazone violet, Winsor & Newton colour, mixed with a bit of burnt umber. But you can use the shadow, as I say, to help define the shape of the object itself. A bit more up there, I think. It's a big bird. That's fine. Okay. Maybe just a little bit too much there. Let's take some of that out. It's always best if you can with this shadow work to get it on in one go and not fill around with it too much as I'm doing here. And they're right where the feet are touching the ground. I always say this to people who I'm painting with. If you look at your hand against the top of the desk or whatever else, right where the hand is touching the surface, it's extremely dark. So we just want to maybe just make that a little bit... Oops. Too much dark underneath there. That'll be okay. That's fine. Okay, I think for a couple of fun puffins, that's us. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope it's given you a bit of inspiration. We've used it on puffins here, I use it on cows, I use it on all sorts of animals. And the thing to do is to play. It's not to be too serious about what you're doing here, and refine it to suit your own wishes as far as the finish of the painting is concerned. And here is the final painting, mounted, signed. You'll notice that I put a bit of splatter on it as well to help with the feeling of movement. So I hope you've enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching, and happy painting.